In our last lecture, we were discussing about the spatial filtering of images, where we considered the local averaging and the median filtering. And we also discussed there that the primary purpose of using such filters was that if we have some noisy pixels present in the image, then by application of the local averaging or the median filter, the effects of those noisy pixels will get smoothened out. Now, in today's class, we are going to discuss about the image sharpening filters. But before that, let us consider some of the preliminaries of image filtering. Now, what we were doing in the last class was, we had an image given as U of MN, and we were performing the spatial averaging and at the output we were getting a low pass filtered version of the image. So that is what I am writing as the output as VMN, V with suffix LP. LP stands for the low pass filtering. So basically spatial averaging, as we saw, okay, that is basically reducing the higher frequency components present in the image. Higher frequency means the higher spatial frequency components present in the image, okay. So it is actually a low pass filtering, and this low pass filtered version is being written as VLPMN, okay. Now supposing we do the image filtering in this manner. Supposing we have U of MN over here, and then we pass it through a low pass filter block. That means to say, doing the spatial averaging, let us say. And this is the output of the low pass filter. And supposing we subtract the output of the low pass filter from the, I mean low pass filtered image from the original image. The original image is right here. So we take the original image, okay, and we feed it to an unit, okay, where we are subtracting the low pass filtered version of the image, okay, from the original. If we do that, then what can we expect at the output? The output of this block, okay, that is to say here, the output here should be a high pass filtered version of the image, because the original is there, and the and from the original image we are reducing the low pass filtered components, okay. That means to say only the high pass filtered components will be present as the difference between the original and the low pass filtered version. So here at the output we should get the high pass filtered version. So I am writing this as V of MN with suffix HP. HP stands for the high pass filter, okay. Now where should we use such kind of filters, this high pass filter images? Low pass filter, yes, we had seen that in order to reduce noise, okay, we had used the low pass filter. But where should we use high pass filter? What is the application for that?
Sharpening of image, yes. So wherever we would like to emphasize the details of the image, we need to take the high pass filter of the particular image. And the high pass filter, one way of getting the high pass filter is simply subtract the, I mean if you know how to get a low pass filtered image, subtract the low pass filtered image from the original one and get it. There is yet another way out, okay. That means to say, we may like to do both low pass filtering as well as high pass filtering. And I tell you where we specifically need such things. It is possible that we have got an image, okay, where some amount of noise is present in the image, okay,
And in that noisy image, you'd like to extract some intensity variations, okay, in presence of noise. So there are two things which are involved. Firstly, we need to reduce the noise, okay, for which we have to do a low pass filter, and we need to increase the, or rather we need to sharpen the image, because we'd like to get more details present in the image. So we also need to do a high pass filtering, okay, and the combined effect of these two, okay, leads to a band pass filtering, and we have a situation like this. Say again we take U of MN, that is the original image, and we pass it through a low pass filter LPF, and this is the low pass filter output, okay, and let us say that we call this as H of L1 MN, that is the first low pass filter, and then we have yet another low pass filter, okay, H of L2 I call this MN, okay, and supposing I subtract one from the other, okay, assuming that the cutoff frequency for this low pass filter is higher than the increased cutoff frequency from this low pass filter, I mean which I am subtracting, that is to say this is the low pass filtered image number 1, this is low pass filtered image number 2, and I am assuming that the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter 1, okay, is higher than that of cutoff frequency of low pass filter 2. If I have that, then it is equivalent to a band pass filtering. Exactly the same analogy holds good for the usual low pass filtering, high pass filtering and band pass filtering of time domain signals. For time domain signals, what we do normally, if we have a signal, okay, which is passed through a low pass filter, and let us say that the low pass filter is having a characteristic of this, low pass filter number 1 is having a characteristic like this, where the cutoff frequency, let us say, is FC1, okay, and if the second low pass filter is having a cutoff frequency, okay, which is given by FC2, okay, this is LPF2, then what is the frequency response of the resultant band pass filter? It will be the overall frequency response will be like this. It will be a band pass filter having cutoff frequency FC1 and FC2. So this is the band pass filter. So we can have realization of high pass filter as well as band pass filter from the low pass filter version of the images. Okay. Now I talked in terms of the cutoff frequency. Cutoff frequency term obviously refers to the frequency domain. Okay. So if we go over to the frequency domain and then apply it, okay, then we can realize a band pass filter. Even in the spatial domain also, it is not very difficult to think in terms of a realization of band pass filter, because effectively the cutoff frequency for a filter means that what is the extent of coverage for that filter. Okay, so it may be that one of the filters is having a 3x3 averaging and the other filter is having a 5x5 averaging or a 7x7 averaging. Okay, and we are just subtracting, okay, one low pass filter output from the other in order to get a band pass filter version. Okay, now let us consider the image sharpening aspects. Okay, which we wanted to discuss in today's class. So, we will be discussing the sharpening filters today. Now, as we have discussed just a little while ago, that the need for sharpening filters is to show more details of the image. Okay. Now, if we would like to show more details of the image, okay, obviously we are not interested in the smooth portion of the image. Smooth means the constant intensity region of the image, we are not much interested. Okay. Supposing we have an image of this nature, supposing this is the entire image and we have a very uniform background, okay, and supposing some object is present, some object having some surface marks on it, okay, supposing this is present on the image, okay, and this is having some background intensity level. Now, if we are trying to sharpen this image, okay, obviously we are not interested in the intensities of the smooth region, okay. Whatever I am showing with these lines, okay, they are all the uniform intensity regions and we are not interested in showing them. So, if we are applying a sharpening filter on an image like this, okay, where there is an object present against a background, okay, by applying the filter on the uniform intensity region, I should get what output? I should get a zero output. I should get zero output when I am applying the filter on the constant intensity region. Whereas, if I am applying the same filter on the region where there are prominent changes of intensities taking place, okay, then what I want is that those changes in intensities must be very well highlighted. Is this clear? I want that the change in intensity should be highlighted, okay, and the uniform intensity regions must be suppressed or must be made zero. So, in order to meet these two requirements, I should have a filter, okay, whose, can you tell me that what should be the summation of the numerical values of coefficients for such a kind of filter?
The first requirement I told you, so there are two requirements, okay.
Two requirements. Number one, that for uniform intensity region, the filter output should be zero. And the number two requirement is that details or changes of intensity should be highlighted. Now, considering the first requirement that for uniform intensity region the filter output should give zero. Now, uniform intensity region means constant intensity. So, if I am applying a filter mask, okay, on a constant intensity region, okay, the filtered output should be zero. So, obviously, what should be the summation of coefficients for this filter? Means, if I design, let's say, a 3x3 filter, okay, and the 3x3 filter elements I call as Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, Z5 is the center of the filter, Z6, Z7, Z8, Z9. So I am considering a 3x3 filter. And I am applying this filter on a uniform intensity region. And my requirement is that in that uniform intensity region, the output should be 0. The filter output should be 0. So can you tell me that what should be the summation of Zi, I is equal to 1 to 9 in this case? That should be equal to 0. Because whenever I am applying this mask on a uniform intensity region, okay, the filter output should be nothing but some constant multiplied by summation of Zi. Alright? And that should add up to 0. Alright. Now, how can we meet this requirement that the summation should be equal to 0 if I am using a non-negative coefficients for these elements? Only if all zeros, but all zero filter does not make any sense. Alright. So, can I construct such a kind of filter with non-negative integers? Not possible. So, I have to construct this filter, okay, with some coefficients which are positive and some coefficients which are negative, so that the summation of those coefficients turn out to be 0. Now, this is the requirement, this is the first requirement I have to fulfill. And the second requirement says that the details or changes of intensity should be highlighted. That means to say that even if there is a change of intensity in just one pixel, okay, that must be well highlighted with respect to its neighbors. Okay. If I have a uniform intensity region otherwise, but suddenly some pixel is having a value which is other than the background value, then that must be properly highlighted. So in order to achieve this requirement, what should be done? The center of the pixel, the center of this mask, the center of this filter, where is the center for this? Z5. So Z5 is the center. So Z5 should be having the maximum value, okay, and all the other elements which are present in the periphery, which are not in the center, should have lower values. And we can construct a filter so that the central element is positive, okay, is highly positive, and the peripheries are negative, in such a manner that the summation works out to be 0. So if we have such kind of filter where Z5 is having a high positive value and all other Zi's other than I is equal to 5, okay, are having negative values, then we will be emphasizing the central pixel of the mask, okay, the center where it is applied, okay, there we will be highlighting the details, okay, and in all other areas we are suppressing it, okay. So we can have a filter whose coefficients are like this. Supposing this is how we construct the filter. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and this one, okay, I take all of them to be minus 1, and this one I take as 8. And because there are totally 9 elements present in this mask, okay, and I am summing up the weighted coefficients for all these 9 ones, okay, overall mask I can multiply by 1 upon 9, okay. So if I apply this filter on the the image, okay, what should you expect out of that image?
Hyperfilter, yes.
So, what we expect there is that the details, okay, should be highlighted, because wherever we have changes of intensities, okay, supposing, let us try to apply this mask, okay, on a region like this. Supposing the original image is weak, like 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, okay, and suddenly I have a pixel having intensity value equal to 5, okay, all other remaining pixel values equal to 1, supposing I apply this mask on this image. Now, whenever I am applying it on uniform intensity regions, okay, I am clearly finding that the output, supposing I choose the center of the mask at this place, okay, what should be the output? The output should be equal to 0, because the summation of coefficients is equal to 0 over here. But if I take this as the center of the mask, okay, if I put the center of mask at this particular point, what should be the output? It should be 5 into 8, 40 for the central pixels contribution, and minus 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, minus 8. So, this gives us an output equal to 32. Okay? So, it is emphasized. The pixel, okay, which is having intensity value different from its background, is being emphasized as compared to the background pixels. All right. Yes, this is an excellent observation. I was coming to that, and it is good that this question has been raised at this point, that if I apply this mask on the image, then I can have negative values. Yes, it is very well possible. Okay? You can choose some regions over here. Let us say, for example, if you choose the mask at this particular point, okay, then for this pixel you are getting 8, and here you are getting minus 5, then minus 7. So totally it comes to minus 4. So you are having negative intensity values, okay, and for uniform intensity regions you are getting 0 values, of course, but for the highlighted pixel you are getting maximum positive. So, it is possible, because the coefficient, some of the coefficients are negative, it is possible that you will get negative values in the hyperfiltered image. So, what you need to do is that after doing the hyperfiltering, you have to apply a proper scaling so that you once again bring the intensities, okay, in the region, okay, of 0 to 255. If you are representing the image, if you are representing the original image with intensity 0 to 255, okay, then after application of the hyperfilter, when you are getting negative values, and it is not only negative values, you may get values which are higher than 255 also. So you need to do a proper scaling, okay, and after doing the proper scaling, you should scale all the intensities within the zone 0 to L minus 1, where L happens to be the maximum intensity level. In our case, we take L to be always 256, because generally in digital images represented in computer, we are taking 256 intensity levels. That is most common. All right. So, it is possible to have negative intensity values, and you must scale down. So that point must be pointed out. Now, if you are applying this kind of a filter on the image, okay, can you tell me, I mean, one point is of course true, that you are highlighting the details. It's obvious, I mean, as we see from this example also, that the image intensity, I mean, that the intensity change, wherever the intensity change is taking place, we are getting tremendously high values, and in the region surrounding it, we are getting negative values, and in the uniform intensity region, we are getting zero values, okay? But, are we improving this image in all the specs, or are we also losing some amount of information if we are applying this kind of a filter?
We are highlighting the details, no doubt. But
at the same time, if there are slowly varying intensities, okay, present in the image, okay, even that also we will not be able to recognize properly, okay. All these slowly varying regions we will not be able to recognize, because we are losing the lower frequency components of the image, okay. Even the absolute DC value of the image, okay, wherever we have in uniform intensity regions, uniform intensity region doesn't mean that the intensity is zero. The intensity could be a constant intensity, but the filter output says that it is zero. Alright? So, we are losing the low frequency information. So, if we want to have a filter like this, that we will keep some amount of low frequency component of the image, and also at the same time, we should introduce some details, or rather we should introduce some intensity changes. Those must be highlighted. If we do it that way, okay, then possibly the image can look little better. So what we need to do is that instead of taking, now obviously a high pass filtered image as I already said can be written as a low pass filtered image, sorry, rather a high pass can be written as original minus low pass. Now supposing instead of having a filter like this, I multiply the original image by some factor. Let us say I choose some factor, some amplification factor A, okay, where A is greater than or equal to 1, and I take A times original and subtract the low pass filter from it. What would you expect at the output? Should you expect any change? Not just DC components, rather I am introducing all the low frequency components again. Okay, let me see how. Okay, this A times original minus low pass, okay, this kind of a filter is called not as high pass, rather we can call it only as a high boost. This sort of filter, A times original minus low pass, is being mentioned as a high boost filter. So high boost filter output is equal to A times original minus low pass, and I can write it this way. I can write it as A minus 1 times original. If I do that, then I have to add another original image, original minus low pass. Alright, so what we get, A minus 1 times original plus what? Plus the high pass. So basically, a high boost filter is nothing but a high pass filter plus some proportion of the original image. Okay, and as I told that A is greater than or equal to 1. So if I take A absolutely equal to 1, then high boost filter becomes equal to the high pass filter only. But supposing I take A equal to, let us say, 1.2. In that case, what am I doing? In addition to the high pass filter version of the image, okay, we are also adding a 0.2 fraction of the original image. Okay, and thereby we are getting the high boost image. Now, the mask, or rather the filter that we use, the filter mask which we use for the high boost filter is like this. We have it as the central element as some coefficient W and all the peripheral elements as minus 1. Obviously, in this case, we are not having a requirement that the filter coefficients should sum up to zeros, because I want some amount of low frequency components to be there. If I did not want the low frequency component to be there, I would have chosen W equal to what? 8. Okay. But instead of that, if I choose W equal to 9A minus 1, I just multiply all these coefficients by 1 upon 9. If I choose W equal to 9A minus 1 with A greater than or equal to 1, okay, then what do I get? Whenever I have A equal to 1, I have W equal to 8. But if I have A greater than 1, okay, then obviously W becomes a number which is greater than 8. And there we are clearly introducing some amount of lower frequency components also into the image, okay, which we are calling as a high boost filtering rather than a high pass filtering. Is this clear to you? Now, this is not the only way whereby we can get a high pass filter version of the image. Now, let us see in what manner did we get the low pass filter version of the image. We had used a linear low pass filter, was we had used an averaging filter, and averaging in the discrete domain, what does it stand for? Averaging in the discrete domain means, basically averaging means you are adding up the intensities of the neighboring pixel. If I consider a mask of this nature, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, in a 3 by 3 window, what we are doing is we are simply adding up the intensities within this 3 by 3 window. Possibly we are multiplying this by 1 upon 9, but we are just summing them up. So it is equivalent to an integration in the image. So, in order to get a low pass filter, okay, we were doing integration. So, I think the analogy always says that if we want to get the high pass filter, then what should we do? Differentiation of the image. So, if we want to get the high pass filter, we can follow a direct approach by taking the differentiation of the image. And this gives rise to a class of filters which are known as derivative filters. Alright? And we will now discuss that how we can construct different type of derivative filters. So to do that, okay, we will consider, at first we will consider the first derivative. Okay, let us consider the first derivative. So to consider that, okay, let us go back to the continuous domain. Supposing we have a two-dimensional function f of xy, which we are calling as the image function, and we take f of xy to be a continuous function. Now, if we are interested in finding out the first derivative, or rather, if we would like to take the gradient of the function fxy at the point xy, okay, what should we write? The gradient can be written in terms of a vector. In terms of a vector, because there are gradients, we have gradients in the x direction as well as in the y direction. Okay, so this gradient is represented in terms of a vector, where the elements of the vectors are del f del x and del f del y. Okay, and what is the magnitude of this vector? The magnitude of this vector can be written as, I write it as mod of del f, okay. This can be written as, rather, magnitude of del f, I can write it as del f del x square plus del f del y square, and this whole thing to the power half, square root of this term. Okay, this should give us the magnitude, this gives us the magnitude of the gradient. Okay, but again, I have chosen f to be a continuous function, but really speaking, I do not have such a continuous function available with me. I only have discrete image, okay, or rather samples of this continuous function. So if I want to compute del f del x and del f del y, I can't explicitly compute the gradients, because this fxy continuous function is not known to me. So I can only try to approximate these gradients, del f del x and del f del y, I can only approximately compute it from the discrete set of values of the image. Okay, now supposing, in order to compute this gradient at a particular point, okay, I think of applying a mask of this nature. Supposing to compute the gradient, I choose a mask whose elements are, I take them as z1, z2, z3, z4, z5, z6, z7, z8, z9. These are the elements of the mask. Okay. Now, can you tell me that what can I write for the magnitude of del f? The center of this mask is at z5. All right. So if I apply this mask, okay, what should be the approximated value of the magnitude of this?
Sigma Z5 minus Z5 whole square.
Sigma?
I equals to 1 to 9 Z5 minus Z5 whole square.
Okay.
Right. And I'm supposing if I have, or rather, if I have this Z1 to Z9 as the intensities, okay, in a particular region, and I am computing the gradient at the point Z5, okay, I can write it that the gradient's magnitude is approximately equal to Z5 minus Z8 square. What does it give? If I consider this to be the y direction and this to be the x direction, then what is Z5 minus Z8 indicating? Z5 minus Z8 is indicating Z5 minus Z8 approximately represents del f del y. Am I correct? Del f del y is approximately represented by Z5 minus Z8. Okay? And what I wanted to do was del f del y square. So I take Z5 minus Z8 square. Okay? And this plus what? Z5 minus Z6 square. Because Z5 minus Z6, okay, approximately gives me what? Del f del x. So these two together, okay, if I take this gradient and if I take this gradient, I square them individually and add them up, and of course I can take the square root of this overall thing, okay, then I will be able to compute the magnitude of the gradient at that particular point xy, which is here at the center of the mask. Okay. So, what should be the element of this mask? I need not consider this half of the mask. I need not consider Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, Z7, because I am only taking the first difference. What does it mean? I am replacing differentiation in the continuous domain by taking the first difference in the discrete domain. I am taking the first difference in the discrete domain and then I am representing the gradient. So I get this expression. And if I want to represent it by some masks, okay, can you tell me that what should be the element of this mask? I can only consider Z5, Z6, Z8 and Z9, right? So I should use not one but two masks. So what should be the mask size? Firstly, the mask size should be only a 2 by 2 mask, okay, because Z5, Z6, Z8 and Z9 are involved. So by taking this Z5 as the center, or rather this corner as the center, okay, I have two different masks. Okay, in one mask I am computing del f del y, and to compute del f del y, what I need to do? Z5 minus Z8. So this element should be 1, this element minus 1, and these elements are 0, 0. And whereas for the second mask, what should be the elements here? This should be 1, this should be minus 1, because I have Z5 minus Z6. Z5 minus Z6, so I have 1 here, minus 1 over here, and 0, 0. Okay, this gives me the, so there are two masks. So at first I will apply this mask. I mean, it doesn't matter whether at first we apply this mask or this mask. So we have to apply once this mask, and then the output of that must be squared. And then we have to apply this mask on the original image. The output of this must be squared. We should add them up. Okay. We should take the square root of that. And the resultant image which we will get is to be called as a gradient image, or rather the first derivative image. There is nothing wrong in calling it as a first derivative image, and we will call it as also as a gradient image. Now, very often people find that taking the squares and then summing them up, okay, and then taking the square root, this is mathematically a very cumbersome operation, because mind you, you have to do this operation for each and every pixel. Okay, so some people suggested that instead of doing such a kind of rigorous computation, taking the squares, adding them up and then doing the square root, rather than that, we can approximate the gradient magnitude by taking simply a summation of their differences. Rather, if we take, okay, we can approximate del f as the mod of z5 minus z8 plus mod of z5 minus z6. If we do that, again what we have to do, once apply this mask, okay, and then you take the magnitude of this, then you apply this mask, take the mod of this, add the two outputs up, okay, and what you get as the resultant image is an approximated version of the gradient image. Okay. Now, instead of taking the derivatives in the x direction and in the y direction, okay, yet another approximated version for taking the gradient could be by considering a cross operator. Okay. So, another approach of approximation to gradient, okay, is to use the cross difference. And in cross difference, what we are doing is, again, take the original image, okay. We are considering z5 minus z9 square, okay, plus z6 minus z8 square. Rather, instead of taking the gradient in the x and the y direction, we are taking the gradients in the cross direction. Once in this, okay. So, if we want to take gradients in the cross directions, the approximated version of the gradient should be in the discrete domain should be z5 minus z9 square plus z6 minus z8 square, this thing whole to the power half, okay, or instead of taking the summation of square and then taking the square root, another approximated version of the gradient image is take mod of z5 minus z9 plus z6 minus z8, take the mod of this. Okay. So, z5 minus z9 square plus z6 minus z8 square, or rather summation of their difference. Z5 minus Z9 mod plus Z6 minus Z8 mod. Okay. So, this kind of a gradient operation is known as a cross gradient operation. This is called as a cross gradient operation, and we can clearly construct the mask for doing this, for performing this cross gradient operations. How many masks are we going to have? Again, two masks. Okay? And can you tell me the elements of these two masks? Okay? Simply from by looking at this expression, I think it is very easy for you to construct. If I take this as 1, z5 as 1, okay? Then 0 here, 0 here, minus 1. Excellent. And what should be the mask for this? 0, 1, minus 1, 0. Because this is z6, this is z8. Z6 minus z8. This is z5, this is z9. Z5 minus z9. Okay? So these are two operators, and these two masks are known as Roberts cross gradient masks, okay, or some literature describe it as Roberts operator. Some literatures describe it as Roberts operator. So Roberts operator simply means a 2x2 cross operator like this. Alright? Now, obviously, we are taking the first difference of the image over here. Now, in the case of first difference, the mask works out to be a 2x2 mask. But don't you think that we have a little bit of problem with even size mask? Because for odd size mask, we have an advantage that we can position the center of the mask at the desired pixel. Whereas for odd, for even size mask, okay, the center of the mask should be at the corner. So it is little bit disadvantageous. So that is why some people suggested that instead of using a 2x2 operator to calculate the gradient, why don't we use a 3x3 operator to calculate the first difference? So their suggestion was like this, that if you are wanting to calculate the gradient in the y direction, supposing this is the y direction and this is the x direction, some people suggested that if you are calculating del f del y, okay, then best thing you can do is that you subtract the third row, okay, from the, I mean subtract the first row from the third one. If you are doing that, you are taking the first difference only. Subtract the first row from the third one, first difference in the y direction you will get. Then you subtract the third column from the first column and you get an approximated version of the del f del x, the first difference in the x direction. Okay, so thereby we can construct two masks. Okay, and can you tell me that what should be the element of this mask? If I want to subtract the first row from the third row,
-1.
What should be the elements of this?
-1.
What should be the elements of this?
+1.
What should be the elements of this?
0.
Because we are not considering this particular row. Okay? If we are applying this mask, then also we are computing the first difference only. For this one, what should be the elements? If we are subtracting the first column from the third column,
-1
in the first column, and then 1, 1, and 1 in the third column, and 0, 0, 0 in the middle column. Okay. Rather, what we are getting, I can write in terms of the z1, z2, z3, z4, z5, the mask which we had defined in terms of z1, z2, z3 up to z9, okay, we can have it like this. Our del f, okay, becomes approximately equal to z6 plus z7 plus, no, sorry, Z7 plus Z8 plus Z9 minus Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. Okay? So, we have this. Otherwise, we can also consider, this is nothing but This is nothing but del f del y, okay, and we can have del f del x as approximated version of del f del x as z3 plus z6 plus z9 minus mod of Z1 plus Z4 plus Z7. Alright. So this gives us the del f del y, del f del x. And these two operators which we have got over here, they are called as Prewitt's operator. So mind you, Prewitt's operator, okay, is also an approximated version of gradient operator. This gives you the gradient in the y direction, this gives you the gradient in the x direction. Okay. Now, yet another mask was suggested, in which case the elements of this, okay, are same as Prewitt's operator, except for the fact that the middle element, okay, the middle element in the first row and the third row in this case, or the middle element in the first column and the third column in this case, instead of their magnitudes being 1, their magnitudes are taken as 2. Okay, so yet another form of operator was suggested where the mask composition is like this: minus 1, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 2, 1. And another mask, okay, for considering the del f del x is like this: minus 1, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 2, and 1. Okay, so I have just changed these elements into 2s instead of 1. And this operator is called as Sobel's operator. Okay, this is very widely used. Sobel's operator and Prewitt's operator, both of them are very widely used for doing high-pass filtering on the image. Okay, and high-pass filtering means it extracts the details, or wherever there are changes of intensities, those are extracted in the process and they are used for finding out the boundaries in the image. Alright.